The analogy of being, according to the thought of Thomas Aquinas. Everyone agrees that the doctrine of the analogy of being is fundamental to St. Thomas Aquinas' philosophical and theological thought. On the other hand, how to interpret the analogy of being is also one of the most disputed points among commentators on Aquinas. The most important historical source for the doctrine of the analogy of being is Parmenides. Parmenides did not himself profess a doctrine of the analogy of being, but his own philosophical arguments are what led other philosophers to come up with the doctrine of the analogy of being. Parmenides was, in a way, the foil for the doctrine of the analogy of being. Parmenides of Elea, who flourished around 475 BC, is known as the father of metaphysics. He was a Greek-speaking philosopher who lived in modern-day Italy. He argued that there could only be one being, since whatever is not being is nothing. If, however, there were two beings, then those beings would have to differ from one another, but they cannot differ in virtue of nothing. Nor can they differ in virtue of being, since it is common to both of them that they are beings, and you can't differ by what's common. Thus, two beings cannot differ from each other. Thus, there cannot be two beings. All must be one. If Parmenides were right, that all being is one, then the whole world around us, which is full of diverse beings, like trees and colors and smells and other humans, is all an illusion. Aristotle, the Greek philosopher, who studied under Plato and tutored Alexander the Great, was unconvinced by Parmenides' argument. Aristotle pointed out that the word being, or better, is, does not mean just one thing. Rather, being and is are equivocal words. For instance, when I say Socrates is a human, the word is signifies what Socrates is, that is, the very nature of Socrates. But when I say Socrates is pale, or Socrates is short, the word is indicates a feature or accident of Socrates, not what he is. The definition of human belongs to Socrates, since he is a rational animal, but the definition of pale and of short does not belong to Socrates, since he is not a color or a size. So the word is does not always mean the same thing. Sometimes it indicates the substance or essence of a thing, as when we say Socrates is human. Sometimes it indicates something inhering in the substance, that is, an intrinsic accident, as when we say Socrates is pale. Sometimes it indicates only an extrinsic denomination, as when we say Socrates is in the temple, because the building surrounding him is the temple, not because there's anything in Socrates which is called being in the temple. Why does this matter? It matters because Parmenides' argument that all beings are one presupposes that the word being, or is, means only one thing. Socrates and his paleness are both called beings since they are both said to be, but they aren't beings in the same sense. Socrates' paleness is a being because by it Socrates is in a certain way, but Socrates himself is a being in his own right, that is, per se. So Parmenides made a mistake when he said that if there were two beings, they would have being in common, and thus couldn't differ from one another by being. In truth, there can be multiple beings which have in common that they are called by the word being, but they do not have in common what that word means, that is, the nature it signifies. Socrates is a being in one sense, and his paleness, his size, and his location are all beings in different senses. So Socrates differs from his paleness, size, and location by being, since being is equivocal, not univocal. That is, because the word being means many things, not just one thing. Aristotle lists 10 most general things or natures that can be signified by being or is. As we saw in the last slide, Aristotle distinguishes 10 most general things that can be signified by the word is or being. These most general kinds of things are called categories. The word category comes from the Greek word for predicate, because the categories are the most general kinds of predicated things. In Latin, the categories are called predicaments for the same reason. The 10 categories are the following. Substance, for instance, human, dog, tree, and rock. Quantity, for instance, 5 inches. Quality, for instance, good, bad, agile, pale, cold, and triangular. Relation, for instance, equal, greater, father, son, knowledge, perception, or anything else that is what it is in relation to something else. The 5th category is action, or, according to some translations, doing. Examples of this are hitting and kicking. The category passion is also translated sometimes as undergoing. Examples of this are being hit or being kicked. Next, we have the 7th category, the category when, at noon, at 5 o'clock, are good examples of that. Next, we have the category where. An example of this is in the school building. The next category is position. An example of this is sitting, or standing, or crooked. Finally, we have a 10th category, which includes all the external denominations that we give to someone based on human relations, for instance, married, clothed, owner, and armed. These are all things that are relevant for humans and which we extrinsically denominate someone with respect to. So we have 10 categories, and these are the most general kinds of names or natures that we can predicate it of a thing. A word is used univocally when it is used of many things in the same sense, that is, with the same meaning. A word is equivocal, however, as opposed to univocal, when it is used in different senses, that is, according to diverse meanings. The 10 categories are called beings equivocally because the word is used of each of the 10 categories in a different sense. Substance is a being without qualification, but the other 9 categories are beings because by them, substance is modified in some way or another. For Aristotle, being is equivocal, but not purely equivocal. For instance, when I try to hit the bat flying around my room with a bat, the word bat is used in a purely equivocal way. The fact that the same sound is used for the animal and the wooden stick is purely coincidental. Some words, however, are used equivocally in an ordered way. After Aristotle's time, equivocation in an orderly fashion was called analogy. So you'll find St. Thomas speaking of analogy when he's talking about equivocal predication in an orderly way. For instance, a human body is healthy in one sense, that is, because his various organs are operating harmoniously. But medicine is healthy in another sense, that is, because it produces health in the body. And urine is sometimes called healthy in another sense because it gives evidence of health in the body. Notice that in this example, what is healthy in its own right, that is, without reference to something else, is the human body. This is called the prime analogate of the word healthy. The medicine and urine, however, are called healthy by reference to the prime analogate of healthy. Thus, these are secondary analogates of the word healthy. They include the primary analogate in their very definition. Now, analogy can be in reference to a common good or end, as we have seen with the word healthy, which is said in reference to the good of health in the body. Or it can be in reference to a common principle, as when we call the medical procedure and the medical equipment both medical, by reference to the skill of the medical professional. Or in a third way, analogy can be in reference to a common subject. It is in this last way that things are called being. Either what is called being is a being in its own right, that is per se, like Socrates and Phaedo, which are themselves subjects, or it is a being by being a modification of some subject or substance, such as Socrates or Phaedo. So, subjects are beings per se. For instance, Socrates and Phaedo, which are subjects of various attributes, these are beings per se. But things which are attributes of these are called beings by analogy to the prime analogate of being, namely the subject or substance, Socrates or Phaedo. After Aristotle, a host of authors began to consider how Aristotle's analogy of being across the 10 categories applied to God. Unlike paleness and size, which are accidents, that is, attributes in a subject, God is not an accident. He is not in a subject. Nor is God a substance in the same sense that the material things around us are substances. Like the substances around us, for instance, trees, rocks, and humans, he is not a modification of a subject. He is subsistent, not in a subject, just like Socrates and Phaedo. He is a being per se, not in reference to another. Nevertheless, he doesn't share any common nature with any of the substances around us, and he certainly doesn't have any matter or bodily dimensions. So God doesn't seem to belong to any of the categories listed by Aristotle. But the categories are the most general sorts of predicates, and we only speak about anything by using predicates. So it seems that if God isn't in any of the categories, we cannot talk about God at all. One possible solution to this problem is to say that when we talk about God, we are only describing his effects or denying something of him. For instance, when we call God good, we mean that God causes good things. And when we call God incorporeal, we are simply denying a feature of creatures of God. We aren't saying anything positive about what he is. So all speech, according to this theory, about God is either negative or relative. None is positive or substantial. That is, none tells us anything positive about what he is, his substance. St. Thomas showed that this theory we just described does not work. It is true that we do say some things of God in a negative or relative way. For instance, when we call God incorporeal or simple, it is true that we are denying of him something found in creatures, such as bodily dimensions or a multiplicity of parts. Likewise, when we call God Creator or Lord, we are affirming a relation of him, but don't say anything absolute about what he is. But not everything we say of God is negative or relative. Some predicates said of God affirm something about what God is in himself. For instance, if when we call God good, we merely mean that he causes good things, as the theory we just described supposed, it would be equally proper to call God a foot, or a rock, or a tree, since he also causes feet, rocks, and trees. But this is obviously silly. Obviously, it is more proper to call God good than to call him a rock. So when we call God good, we can't merely mean that he causes good things. We must be saying something positive about his nature. For St. Thomas, there are three ways of naming God. The first way, as we've already hinted, is negatively. The second way, relatively. This we've also discussed to some extent. The third way, however, which was not present in the bad theory we just discussed, is to name God substantially or positively. That is, we can actually say something positive about what God is. An example of the first way is to say God is incorporeal or God is immobile. Here, we deny that some creaturely nature, for instance, motion or bodiliness, corporeality, is found in God. And the second way, namely when we name God relatively, we might say something like God is creator or God is Lord. Here we do not say anything about what God is in himself, absolutely, but only denominate him from our relation to him, our being created and governed by him, for instance. An example of the third way of naming God is to say God is good. Here we affirm some perfection found in creatures of God, but deny that this perfection is found in him according to the same mode as it is in creatures. So we are really saying something about what God is, albeit what we're saying is not adequate to how God is, to his mode of being. This is because effects are similar to their cause, but creatures are the effects of God. And so, taking names from creatures, we can even name God in a positive or substantial way, albeit we aren't naming him in an adequate way. To understand how substantial predication about God works, we have to understand the relationship between words, concepts, and things. Words signify concepts, but things cause concepts. And, as a result, concepts are the likenesses of things. When we know a thing directly, for instance, heat, color, and noise, we form a concept that is a perfect likeness of the thing. God, however, is not known immediately, but only through his effects, which are creatures. We have to reason to the existence of God from his effects. We don't know his existence or nature immediately, as we do with respect to heat, color, and noise. Now, creatures have some characteristics which include imperfection, and other characteristics that do not include imperfection. For instance, humans and trees are mortal. Mortality is a characteristic that includes limitation and imperfection. But being good, not being in a subject, as an accident, and being wise are all pure perfections, meaning that they do not include any defect, even if they are had by creatures in a finite and defective mode or way. In the first respect, creatures are not like God, but in the second, they are like him, although not perfect likenesses. Although both God and creatures are good, the way or mode in which God is good is diverse from and infinitely exceeds the mode in which creatures are good. Nevertheless, since A, creatures are a likeness of God with respect to pure perfections, and since B, concepts formed from creatures are a likeness of creatures, and C, words signify concepts, our words can signify God positively through certain of our concepts that are taken from creatures, signifying their pure perfections, such as goodness and wisdom. So let's see how this works. Let's replace the thing signified, which causes the concept, with a more precise description of that thing. Here, the thing, which the concept is a likeness of, is a pure perfection in creatures. So, the concept is a likeness of a pure perfection in creatures, which itself is the cause of that concept. But God himself is the cause of the pure perfection in creatures, and therefore, the pure perfection in creatures is a likeness of God. So now the word signifies a concept, which is a likeness not only of the pure perfection in creatures, but also of God himself through being a likeness of the pure perfection in creatures. So by that word, we can name not only the creature who has the pure perfection, but also God, since God produces the pure perfection, and therefore the pure perfection is a likeness of God, and therefore the concept itself, which is signified by the word, is also a likeness of God. So in this way, we can name God substantially or positively. That is, we can say something positive about what he is in his substance. To summarize, then, there are three ways in which we can name God: negatively, relatively, or substantially and positively. Positive substantial names for God are taken from creatures, and this sort of predication is based on the fact that creatures are the likeness of God, since every effect resembles its cause. But creatures are not the perfect likeness of God. Therefore, we have to draw a distinction. With respect to the perfection signified, substantial names for God are more true of God than of creatures. But with respect to the creaturely mode of signifying, which is based on the way in which we perceive the perfection in creatures, substantial names for God are inadequate to God and more appropriate to creatures than to God. For instance, good is more properly said of God than creatures, in the sense that the goodness of God far excels the goodness of creatures. But the way in which we understand what good means is more proper to creatures than God, because our mode of understanding is taken from the creatures directly around us, and we only know God indirectly through his effects, which are creatures. We don't know the mode in which God has the perfections he has. We only know that he has them. As we saw, being is analogical because it means different things. Sometimes it means substance, sometimes quantity, sometimes quality, etc. There are 10 most general things it can mean, and these constitute the 10 categories given to us by Aristotle. But God's nature falls under none of these 10 things. He is not a substance in the sense creatures are, nor is he a quantity, nor a quality, etc. Nevertheless, we can name God from the categories in one of three ways: negatively, by denying some being in the categories of God. For instance, when we say God is incorporeal, that is not a body. Body is in the category substance, and we're denying this creaturely quality of God. Secondly, we can name God relatively by denominating God from the fact creatures are really related to him. For instance, since creatures are caused and governed by God, we can call God creator and governor, or Lord. That's because creatures are really governed by him and created by him, and this real relation from creatures to God includes in our understanding a relation from God to creatures. So we name God relatively as creator and governor. Finally, in a third way, we can name God in a substantial or positive way, by predicating of God a word signifying a pure perfection found in creatures. Here we predicate of God something found in the categories, but we deny that in God it is found in the same way it is found in the categories. For instance, wisdom in creatures is in the category quality, but in God, it is not in the category quality, but possessed in a more perfect way than we can grasp. Aristotle explained the analogy of being or is across the 10 categories of corporeal natures around us. St. Thomas accepted this theory, and he also expanded the analogy of being or is beyond the 10 categories of corporeal natures around us to the cause of those categories, God himself, who we can name using names taken from creatures, that is, from the categories. So far, we have only been discussing actual beings outside the mind, God and the 10 categories of corporeal nature. But Aristotle extends the analogy of being beyond the predication about things outside the mind. For instance, we can say Homer is blind or Mr. Cromwell is stupid, but that implies that blindness is in Homer and stupidity is in Cromwell. So even a non-being like blindness and stupidity, which signify the absence, not the presence of something, can be said to be in some sense. Why is that? To understand how even non-beings can be called beings by analogy, that is, they can be called beings in some sense of the word being, let's look at Aquinas' explanation of how the word being is extended in an analogical way in his commentary on Book 4 of the Metaphysics, Lecture 1. Now, as we've already seen, the prime analogate of the word being is substance. Substance is a being per se, that is, not in reference to anything else. It's just a being in its own right. On the other hand, there are 10 categories of actual things outside the mind, which are not beings in their own right, but beings by reference to the prime analogate of being, namely in reference to substance, which is their common subject. So far, all of this is review. There's a prime analogate of being, namely substance, which is the primary subject. And then there's 9 accidental categories of actual extramental beings, which are called being not in the same sense as substance, but by reference to substance. That is, by reference to their common subject. But the extension of the word being, analogically, does not end with the 10 categories of actual things outside the mind. Rather, other things can also be called beings by a further extension of the word being, or is. Now, the first extension of the word being is to things like motion, change, and potency. We say not only that the act of building is a being, but also that the potency to build is a being. For instance, we say he is a builder when he's actually building, but we also say he is a builder when he's not currently building, but able to build. That is, he has the potency to build. So we could tack on words to the word is, like possibly or becoming, which change the meaning of the word is to a further analogical sense of that word. For instance, we could say, he is actually 10 feet tall, or he is potentially 10 feet tall, or he is becoming 10 feet tall. The words becoming, or possibly, change the meaning of the word is to a further analogical extension of that word. So motion, change, and potency are all beings in some sense, but they're not beings in the same sense as the 10 categories of actual beings. They're being by reduction to these 10 categories of actual being outside the mind. Now, the word being is extended even further to things which are simply non-beings. The removal of anything from the categories or from what is in positive in motion is also understood by reference to what is removed. And therefore, these removals or negations can also be considered beings by an extension of the word being to such things. For instance, when we say non-being is non-being, or blindness is in Homer. By saying this, we imply that non-being is, or exists, in some sense. The reason is because we understand non-being by what it removes. We understand blindness by sight, evil by good, and darkness by light. Each of these non-beings can be called a being by an analogical extension of the word being from something positive to what removes that positive thing. For these to be called being, it suffices that an affirmative proposition be true in which they are used. For instance, the affirmative proposition, Homer is blind, is true, and therefore we could speak of blindness as if it were a being. Now, of course, we don't mean that blindness actually is a being outside the mind, but we could call it a being. We could use the word being for it by an analogical extension of that word. This last kind of being is called being in the sense of the truth of a proposition, because as a mere condition for something to be called a being in this way, we merely need to be able to form an affirmative proposition that is true about it. Now, St. Thomas distinguishes within these analogical extensions of the word being four different modes of being. The first mode of being is the weakest, namely beings of reason, which are merely called being in the sense that an affirmative true proposition can be made about them. These are beings of reason. They can also be called being in the sense of true only. The second mode of being is the mode of motion or potency. These things are called beings because they are towards something that is a being, more properly speaking, namely the 10 categories outside the mind. So because potency and motion and change are all directed towards some sort of actuality, such as action, passion, relation, quality, or quantity, motion and potency can be called beings by reference to that towards which they are. The third mode of being is the mode of being of accidents. All of these are called beings because they inhere in or are related to substance as their subject. Finally, there is the fourth mode of being, which is the most perfect. This is what is a being in its own right, a being per se, that is not in reference to anything else. This is the prime analogate of being, namely substance. Thus, we have four modes of being going from the weakest to the strongest, the least proper to the most proper. The least proper sorts of beings are beings which don't even exist, properly speaking. For instance, non-being, blindness, stupidity. All of these things are merely called beings because we can use the word is about them in a sentence that's true. Next, we have the second mode of being, which is motion or potency. Here we have something which has something of negation in it, but it's not a pure negation, and it's directed towards some actuality. And so it can be called being in a more proper sense than pure non-beings. Third, we have the accidents, which are attributes or modifications of substance. And so they're called beings because by them a substance is in a certain way. That is, by them a substance exists in a certain way. Finally, we have substance, which is that which actually exists in its own right. So these are the four modes of being, and they explain the analogical extension of the word being all the way from substances like trees, rocks, and Socrates to non-beings like blindness.
Un gran